Let's get into the Word this morning. We're on a series about the Sermon on the Mount. Boy, that's a powerful series. I don't know if you've ever read in the book of Matthew, Jesus was talking about the Sermon on the Mount, and he talked about the Beatitudes. He talked about several other things. And today, in verses 27 through 30, and the next few sessions, we're going to have some things that involve our lives and things that we need to be conscious of. I'm a firm believer that we need to proclaim, teach, and preach the whole counsel of God. You can't pick, choose, and declare what you want to do. You've got to preach the whole counsel of God. That includes some areas of sensitivity. That includes some things that we need to look at, deal with in our lives that will help us to be better Christians. Today we're dealing with a subject of fatal attraction. And I'm in Matthew chapter 5, 27 through 30. And as we continue in this series today from the Sermon on the Mount, I'm dealing with a difficult sermon or lesson matter today. But it was important to Jesus, and he included it in the Sermon on the Mount. So if he did that, he wants us to know about it, doesn't he? And so therefore we can receive this and understand God's Word. Interesting note for you, back in 1631, I don't think any of you were around those years, were you? There was an edition of the King James Bible printed that some refer to as the Wicked Bible. You say, Wicked Bible? Yes. In the 1631 edition, they omitted one word. A three-letter word starts with an N, ends with a T, and an O in the middle, spelled not. Now, from Exodus 20 and 14, so it read, "Thou shalt commit adultery." That's not the version you want. It was an omission, and it was an error. And I'm sure some people went wild with it. But anyway, but if you survey the contemporary landscape of today and examine the American view of morality, which you would have to be blind not to see what's happening in not just our nation but around the world, and has been for some time, the wicked version may be more true of our character today than the real version. So there's a website. I'm not even going to give the name. I did some research on this, not on the website, but on this subject that I'm dealing with this morning. And this is what this website actually says. Life is short. Have an affair. Now, I'm not telling you to go do that. Okay, that's what they're saying. For God's sake, don't do that. You don't want that. It says you might be surprised how many Christians actually use this website. That's appalling, isn't it? To think that within the ranks of church and people who attend church and people who may even be active and involved in church, and they're involved in stuff like this. Further quotes, and this is a quote, having faith doesn't necessarily mean you're faithful to your spouse. Now, by the way, I read about this in a Christian article that I discovered by a Christian author. However, this site was never clicked on by my computer. And I can tell you that honestly and truthfully, with integrity today, I didn't even subject my computer to even go to that nasty place. Do you understand what I'm talking about this morning? Our culture is in violation of God's command. His word, the entirety of His word, is a command to us. And if we don't heed the command, we're in violation of it. Now, television refers to adultery and other fornicative acts more than basically 13 times more frequently than fidelity between a husband and a wife. It's become a very accepted practice today. The magazine Christianity Today did a survey some time back and discovered that over 23% of their subscribers had engaged in adulterous acts. Now, Jesus broached the subject in the Sermon on the Mount. Was it important? Sure it is. Because our moral purity is important, isn't it? Isn't that one of the things that we've let slip within our nation and in our world? Isn't that something that today that we need to be more conscious of? Sure we do. We just can't skip over these verses. You can't go to the Bible and say, well, let's teach and preach on this, but that's a sensitive area. That's a hot topic. That, you know, you've got to deal with the entirety of the Word of God. So if God addressed it today, we need to get our spirit in tune with what He says. We need to obey what the Word of God says. Now, according to statistics, the most searched word on the internet is a three-letter word that ends with S and, begins with an S and ends with an X and it's got an E in the middle. Sex. Y'all are mighty quiet this morning. Which can be a fatal attraction. So, do you realize that Christian people live in bondage today? Really, they do. They live in bondage. They're Christian people who live in bondage to pornography. They live in bondage to sex, adultery, fornication, and sexual perversion. We don't know what goes on in the minds of people, do we? We don't know what goes on with their little fingers on keyboards, do we? We don't know what people do in the dark of the night, in the late of the night. We don't know people's lives, maybe as we think we do. But it's important today that we maintain integrity in all areas of our living. We talk about integrity. That does not exclude today the issue today of being pure in God's sight in all areas of your living. So when you live outside of fidelity today in the marriage, it's going to affect the church and it will also affect your home. So it's very important. And I don't know your conditions this morning. I'm not here to dredge up anybody's past. If your past is under the blood, you can thank God for that because your sins are blotted out and they're not charged against you any longer. Amen. But Jesus in Matthew 5, 27 through 30 is not only concerned with the external consequences of immorality, Jesus also addresses the internal causes. And before committed with the hands, sin is committed with the heart. So you think, well, I didn't do anything. Well, if it passed through your heart and went through your mind, you need to repent of it. You need to keep your vessel pure and clean before the Lord. I'm not being legalistic this morning, by the way. I'm just giving you the Word of God because this is a part of what He says in His Word. So we need to apply it to our lives. So Jesus never lowers the standard of moral purity. Jesus actually raised the standard of moral purity to protect the outside and the inside. He wants you clean on both areas of your life. If you keep your heart clean, you'll keep the exterior of your life right with the Lord. I'm not talking about bathing. That's you really need to bathe too. But you need to keep your heart right and clean before the Lord. So sexual sin is not only evidence in what we do, but it's also evidence in what we desire. Now these verses in Matthew chapter 5 today place basically three demands on Christians that we need to heed. And you think, well, you know, I'm at this place in my life and so forth. You never get too old or at a point and a time in your life that you don't need to have the entirety of God's Word refreshed in your spirit. The first thing that we're going to talk about today is you must respect the scriptural case against adultery. Matthew 5:27, Jesus says, "You've heard that it was said by them of old, thou shalt not commit adultery." Now, Jesus is quoting from what? The Ten Commandments from the Old Testament, correct? Well, preacher, come on. That's under the law. That's Old Testament. That's not applicable to the day of grace, and it's not applicable to the day that we're living in today. Big wrong on that. God's Word is applicable to everything, whether it's old, whether it's new. If you look at the Ten Commandments, they are a measuring stick of standard for us to live by. Do we miss it? Sure we do. Probably every one of us, I would say every one of us in this room, have violated Ten Commandments somewhere in the Word of God. That's why a lot of people think if you keep the law, the covenant of the law, that you're okay. Our Jewish friends think, you know, you do it by the law. We're not saved by the law. We're saved by grace. And let's understand this too. As we talked about last week, Jesus didn't come to destroy the law, but He came to fulfill it. So what was proclaimed in the Old Testament is evidenced in the New Testament and is a part of our lives. So He didn't dismiss the scripture. As a matter of fact, what Jesus did, He actually made more declaration and went into more depth on it. So Jesus is not correcting the Old Testament law. So get that first. But rather He is correcting the misinterpretation of the law. People misinterpret the Bible. I'm going to be preaching tonight on a hot subject of the Holy Spirit or the Holy Ghost. A lot of people have a misinterpretation of the Holy Spirit. A lot of people have a misinterpretation of the Bible. A lot of people have a misinterpretation of salvation. See, there's a lot of issues. And so you need the right interpretation. Jesus came to clear the air so that you've got the right interpretation. Verse 27 makes it clear that adultery is not an option. So adultery, the word adultery really is an interesting word from that standpoint. Adultery not only refers to extramarital affair outside the bonds of marriage, outside of the fidelity that should be between a husband and a wife, but it also can refer to any sexual relations outside of the marriage boundary. So you go to verse 28 of Matthew 5, and the Bible says, "But I say unto you that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery with her already in his heart." So you... And this is just not for the guys. This is for the gals too. You need to keep your eyes on your own wife or your own husband, not somebody else's. Amen? Jesus is saying we have to be careful that we don't fall prey to this issue or this sin of adultery. More homes have been destroyed by this. More relationships. More homes have been affected by this. And it affects not only the home, but it affects the church. It affects the culture or the society that we're living in. Do you realize that America probably has the highest divorce rate of any nation in the world? Yeah. 1 Corinthians 6 and 9 says, Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, that's speaking of the homosexual, nor abusers of themselves, with mankind. We have to respect what the Bible teaches about sexuality, whether married or not. So we have to take the power and the value of God's word and apply it to our life. We must acknowledge and respect what Jesus said. If you don't, then you're disrespecting the word of God, and therefore then you're in violation of God's word and you've sinned against God. I'm glad to tell you today there is a means of forgiveness. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. You may have blown it in the past. You may have messed up. And just not this wise, any wise. I'm glad there's a God who forgives sin. Because you know what? If he didn't, every one of us today would really be in deep trouble. We would have no hope of salvation. So therefore today, We need to pray for people. We need to encourage people. We don't condemn. We're not the judge and we're not the jury. But what we need to do is be an example and love people and pray for them and show them there's a better life. Even though we live in a wicked society, Jesus does not lower the standard of purity, but he actually raises the standard to align with the word of God. So we have to raise our standard so that our standard meets the standard of God's word. When you do that, then you're never wrong. In today's environment, we're bombarded today with images everywhere of sexual impurity. I mean, you can't watch a commercial anymore. Everything. You can't even watch a commercial with Hardee's hamburgers. Come on. How pathetic and how perverted is that? Some Jezebel, some sleazy, slimy-looking gal on there. I mean, you know, come on. Can't we clean up things a little bit, you know, in our society? The inner desire for illicit sexual pleasure today of contemplated and not rejected is sin. So I've got two points here that are very important today. Point number one, the Christian must be particularly careful to abstain from taking pleasure in scenes of immorality or nudity such as shown in films, videos, TV, books, or internet sites. One of the greatest perversions that people have disposal to today is the internet. Not only that, but television, whether you're on DirecTV, Dish Network, or cable, it's all out there. But you know there are safeguards today that you can use that will keep you away from stuff like that? Amen. If you've got a weakness, you've got to admit you've got a weakness and seek God's guidance. But listen, don't go looking at stuff like that because that's not helping your weakness. That's drawing you into that circle of sin. Second thing is today, in the area of maintaining sexual purity, the woman as well as the man has a responsibility. So we all share that responsibility. The issue is not what the scripture says. The real question is, will we lower the standard today, or will we align ourselves with the standard of what God says in His Word? Don't lose sight of this fact. This is very crucially important. This is why we're in the trouble that we're in today. We have lost the value of the cornerstone of society, which is the family. And that's why we are desperately in trouble today, is because we have forgotten the cornerstone of integrity in our families. So homes around us is unraveling because of sexual immorality. Marriages are falling apart because of infidelity. And you understand that word, infidelity, not being true to your mate. None of us deserve good marriages until we respect the Bible's teaching about marriage. So you've got to understand, if you're wondering what the role of the husband and the wife is, read Ephesians 5. It's very explicit and very clear and very defined. It'll tell you your responsibility. Mark my word today, pleasure without commitment is not going to satisfy. And so adultery is a dead-end street. It's a sinful street. It's a street that we have to deal with. Only way to be happy is to repent. The only way today to get the joy bells of God back in your life is to repent, get right with God, and get your family right with God and stay right with God, right? You're not going to marry your lover and be happy. So, you know, if you got a little something going on the side, you think, well, I'm going to leave her and marry her, and it's not going to work. It just doesn't work. You read the statistics. If we respect the scriptural case against adultery, we have to reclaim the life God gave us, and we have to fight for the family that God gave us. You've got to keep and maintain your moral integrity. Amen. Now, when you cheat, you're not just cheating on your spouse, but you're cheating on your entire family. If you choose to cheat, I'll just put it this way. If you choose to cheat, you choose to lose, because you're going to lose a whole lot more than you could ever imagine. Second thing today, Jesus said, reject the sexual compromise of adultery. Verse 28 again, he says, but I say unto you that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery with her already in his heart. That old statement that says, it's okay to look as long as you don't touch. No, that's not right either. Amen. Now, I know we cannot walk through life with your hands over your face and over your eyes. And it's nothing wrong with people taking care of themselves and looking nice and looking attractive. But you need to keep your eyes off of somebody else's wife and off of somebody else's husband. Thank you, Pastor. The danger of lust is this. It causes you to want what you don't have instead of enjoying what you do have. Amen. Jesus is saying it's just not avoiding the act of adultery, but also the ambition of adultery also. If you find in another what you can't find in your spouse, you are in violation of what God has warning us about. So you must reject the sexual compromise of adultery. And that's what it is. It's a compromise today. It brings a lot of consequences. And I'm tired of society perverting what God says is a good thing. The marriage relationship today and the right relationship today and even the sexual relationship within a marriage, it is, God honors that. But when you step outside the bonds of and have an affair with somebody else's wife or husband, I'm going to tell you right now, God's not pleased with that. Amen. It's not okay to pursue reckless pleasure. And so men and women need to be careful today because especially through the media today of the internet, pornography is available with the click of a button. And I mean, it's out there. Everywhere you look, this is addictive behavior that will destroy you and your home. And folks, listen to these statistics. I didn't drum these up. These are actual. 9 out of 10 children between the ages of 8 and 16 have used pornography on the internet. Don't you think you need to put guidelines on your internet, on your computer? And not just for your kids, maybe you need it for yourself too. That surely will take away any temptation, won't it? Pornography is what I would call the weapon of mass destruction aimed at the family to destroy it today. And let me tell you, it's out there, folks. It's prevalent. And it's not limited to men. As I said, it's also in the area of women. Jesus knew what he was talking about when he dealt with this subject. And the world, by the enticement of sinful Satan today, is basically violating God's standard for the home and the family. See, Satan's smart. He knows today if he wants to ruin and if he wants today to decay the fiber of our society, he attacks the home and the value of the home and the relationship between a husband and a wife. And he knows how to break down, because if you break down the home, you've broken down the church and you've broken down the community and you've broken down the nation. And that's where we are today. You know, we think, well, our economics are bad. You know what's worse is our morals. You know what's really today the core that's eating away at our society today is the fact today that homes are not staying homes. Amen. Thank God for the grace of God that homes can have a healthy marriage. Hallelujah. Cynthia and I have a healthy marriage. And that's not because she said it, not because I said it. It's because we worked at it to make sure it's healthy. Amen. When you got the best, what else do you want? Amen. That's the way you should feel about your husband or your wife. When you got the best, what else is there? Right? Hello? Okay. If you want a good marriage, then the principle of Jesus, then stay committed both in heart and hand with the spouse that God has given you. And let me give you one more thing this morning. This has gone fast this morning, hasn't it? It has for me, maybe not for you. Remember the saving cure for adultery. Let's go back to 29 and 30. And if thy right hand offend thee, you say, wait a minute, preacher, I don't know if I want to read this or not. If thy right hand offend thee, pluck it out and cast it from thee. For it is probable for thee that one of thy members should perish, and not that the whole body should be cast into hell. And if the right hand offend thee, cut it off and cast it from thee. For it is profitable for thee that one of thy members should perish, and not thy whole body should be cast into hell. Jesus is not telling you to literally to go out here and take and gouge your eyeball out, or cut your hand off, and take a hatchet and sever your body parts off of you. He didn't say anything about that. Read it in the context that he's speaking of. The problem is the heart and the mind. The hand does what the mind and the heart tells it to do. The problem is a lack of Christly focus in our lives. Get your focus off of your flesh and get your focus on your faith. Amen. What Jesus is saying in Matthew 5, 29 through 30 is, do you want to live spiritually, and do you want to walk with God? I mean, really, how do you want to walk today? If you're not walking with God, then you're walking in the flesh. Jesus is saying you have to guard and fight to protect your spiritual life. So whatever is causing you to stumble, here's a very simple plan. Get rid of it. Get the trash. Take the trash out. Amen. And if you're having problems with pornography and sexual sins and perversion, then get rid of it. If you have trouble with the internet, stay off of it. If you have trouble watching TV and going to the wrong places, either disconnect it or put safeguards on it. I mean, there are ways to get around this. And in closing this morning, I've got some helpful barriers that will give you some strength and guidance in your life. And it's about six of them. These today are just common knowledge things that we need to be refreshed in, that we are cautious in our walk and our relationship, that we don't stumble. You know, you can, one fleeting moment can cost you your whole family. One fleeting moment of passion can cost you a whole lot more than you were ever willing to pay. Amen. And those barriers include things like this, very simple but very profound. Don't meet with opposite sex for lunch if you're married. I don't have lunch with women. I don't care what it's for, unless my wife is there. Amen. So it's important today. You say, well, why? She doesn't trust you? No, I guard my testimony. Amen. I guard my walk. I guard my integrity. And you know, I may go to lunch with a lady, if I did, and absolutely nothing happened. But you know what? I've created a question mark. Hey, that's Preacher Duck. I wonder what he's doing with that lady there, taking her to lunch. And then, buddy, let me tell you what, Facebook goes livid. Amen. Carlton Duck was seen with another woman at a restaurant. Carlton Duck and Cynthia are having problems in their home. And I'm telling you, it just snowballs from hell. Amen. I'm serious. It will, man. I protect my integrity. Amen. Second today, don't offer workers or acquaintances of the opposite sex a ride anywhere. Yeah, but preacher, if I saw somebody that I was working with and standing at the bus stop and it was pouring down rain, what should I do? Why don't you just tell them to take your car and you'll wait at the bus stop and you'll get your car later on? See, there are ways to get around this. Amen. Three today. If you can't handle the internet, get filters or get off of it. Simple. Amen. Be cautious. Number four, keep your TV viewing clean by blocking bad channels. I don't care if you got 180 or 280 or 580 channels on your TV set. I don't care how many you got. You can still have a device that you can block anything that you don't want to see. Right? And if you can't handle that, then just throw the thing out the window. Amen. Hallelujah. And be careful of the movies that you go to and the music that you listen to. You know, did you see so-and-so? They came out of an X-rated movie. And not only that, but you know, the music that we listen to, because if you're not cautious, a lot of this, I have nothing against country music, but I'm going to tell you what. Two-thirds of it is some guy shacking up with somebody else's wife. Don't need it when you got something far better, Christian music. Amen. And if you can't handle that, just cut it all off and drive down the road and sing to yourself. Jeez. Amen. And I got a last one for you. If necessary, get you an accountability partner. Get somebody that you're accountable to. And that's a man with a man and a woman with a woman. Okay? Get your mind off your flesh and get your heart on God by faith. And when you do that, you know what? You'll maintain your moral integrity. As I close this morning, there's one final note. Watch spiritual adultery too. I didn't deal with that. But you know what? You can commit spiritual adultery with the Lord. You can't let other things keep you from God. And maybe you haven't committed a moral sin, but today you're committing a spiritual sin by today putting everything else ahead of God and flirting with the world, flirting with the devil, and not giving God your life. And today, you've got to stay committed to Christ, you've got to stay committed to the Word, and you've got to stay committed to the Lord and His work instead of the world and the flesh. So, what is keeping us today from living spiritually? We've got to live as God has declared in His Word. And how we're living your life for God is crucially important that we live and we live right for the Lord. There's a better way to live. Choose to live for Christ and to yield your life to Him. You'll never go wrong with that. And there's no sin that the blood of Jesus will not cover and blot out and remove. Isn't that good news today? So today, you know what we need to do. We need to pray for people. People make bad decisions, bad choices. Need to pray for them. Need to pray for them and be an example to them, be an encouragement to them. Get your life straight. Get right with God. Live for the Lord. Serve God. Be faithful to Him. And let God do a mighty work in your life. Maintain today. Watch fatal attractions. Because, folks, it can carry a lot more damage than you could ever imagine. Stay right. Stay pure. Stay good for God. And God will bless you awesomely, won't He? And the church said, amen. Amen. Haven't we had fun this morning? Amen. Amen. Thank you, Father, for the Word of God, quick, powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword. Thank you that we can receive the message of the Word. It changes us. It tools us. It fashions us. It forms us into the image that you would have us to be. Thank you that, Lord, we can proclaim your Word with liberty and freedom. And, Lord, we find in the Word of God freedom. We find truth. We find the value of good living today. And help us today to cleave to those things that, Lord, that will encourage, lift up, and change us for your good and your glory. And, Lord, avoid today and stay away from the things today that would pull us down. Cleave to the Lord. Look to Jesus. Thank you for this day. The people that have gathered here today, we're excited about what we're going to partake of today, that we're at the table of the Lord. And, Lord, you have got an awesome meal prepared for us today. Spiritual food that will strengthen our life and draw us ever closer to you. Have your will in your way as we prepare for worship. May, Lord, the our hearts be attuned to the things of God, and may we worship you in spirit and in truth, and may we declare great is our God and greatly to be praised. For it's in Jesus' name we pray, and the children of God thank the Lord with a clap of the hand and a shout of amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's get ready for worship.